Take the gyroscope, spin it up, push down on its axis, it'll pivot one way. You push it up, it'll pivot the other way. You go at the opposite end, everything reverses. You push down parallel to its axis, it will not pivot. It clearly showed me the energy in a magnetic field had to be a gyroscopic particle. It would spin in its seat, and it was going forward at sea. It was a mechanical essence of Einstein's equation of E equals mc squared. And so in 1968, I was certain that I was correct. I didn't care what the rest of the world was saying, because they could not answer my honest question. How do you know why can you tell me what's happening when you move this conductor through a magnetic field? I'd go to the physics department. I incorporated astronomy in this all the way through the universe, showing that there's the magnetic field that prevails our entire galaxy, and that this gyroscopic particle went all the way to the wave and particle theory of light, and I explained that it did, and this is something that science has argued about for over 100 years, and I've noticed that a lot of technical people, when I've shown them this, they've all been amazed, and I'll give it a demonstration to you that'll amaze you. And what they had argued about for hundreds of years, they noticed that they had a big hole, and they had light going through it, that they had noticed a little fringe around the outer periphery of this light as it cast an image, and they call it a phenomenon. They couldn't explain it exactly. They knew it was there. Now, what really blew the scientific community's mind, everything worked correctly as they predicted, as they went down smaller and smaller in that whole diameter, letting the light through it. The image would get smaller and smaller and smaller until they got down to a little tiny hole. Then all of a sudden, it'd make a tremendous image, and it acted like a wave. And the scientific community was dumbfounded. Now, if you look at the laws of a gyroscope, and you take Newtonian mechanics and the laws of hydraulics, it explains that to a T. Because I say light is gyroscopic particles going in the same direction, and when they try to go through a large hole, you have pressures, the laws of hydraulic apply, they move at right angles through the outer periphery. It's like if you've got three people trying to walk through a door, the people on the outside, they brush against the door and they feel it. The person on the inside is not affected as much. It's the same thing with the light. As it goes through the outer periphery of it, it's going to move at right angles through that force, and it causes that little wave that's around that area of the image that's cast.
It bends the light slightly then, right?
Well, it moves at right angles to it. And as it does, it comes out of phase to your eyesight, and so you see this out of focus. And now picture, though, by the laws of mechanics, if you get down and you picture these gyroscopic particles trying to get through this hole, and it's trying to squeeze through there, and Newtonian mechanics is saying that it's going to move at right angles to this force, and when it does, this is what it's going to do. It's going to open up, out. So you can see my hand, I'll do it this way. When it goes through there, it's going to open out, and it makes this big image. Now, the first time I noticed that I had put forth a unified field theory was Dr. Smith, who was chief of space environment branch at Huntsville. He contacted me, saying, Joe, that he couldn't get anybody at NASA in Huntsville, Alabama, to debate with me. But they wished to compliment me on my efforts to put forth a unified mechanical field theory, that my logic was so rigid that they could not attempt to debate with me. And he said, Joe, what they're saying is that you're right. And just like on the astronomy section of this book, I showed that the Earth's true axis is a result of the Earth's magnetic axis warped in outer space as it aligns with the sun. I took the known astronomy numbers, and they were so exacting that Dr. Smith, who was chief of space environment branch in Huntsville in 1977, had his statistician look at those numbers. He said the chances of me being wrong was almost totally impossible. Now, what it shows is that the Earth is an electromagnetic device. In its motion and position relative to the sun, is relative to the effects of electromagnetic energy as it travels in its orbit around the sun. And the sun is the same way in its own galaxy, and our galaxy is that to some other central body. I'm very certain of that. And many things have been done in science now proving the things that I said was correct, even to the point where they were saying that the universe was expanding straight out. Now they're saying, well, they find this is not true. Now, I had predicted this and published in this book in 1984. If they had found that these orbits were such masses distance, if you took any short line of that, I don't care if it's a million miles you take of it, it's still a short line relative to the distance of its orbit. So when you look at it, it's going to appear to you like a straight line, but it's being curved. And they have found this to be the case since they have put a telescope in outer space and been making observations, and they're dumbfounded by it. but yet I wrote this up and predicted it would be in 1984. Mm-hmm. It shows that the magnitude of what this technology is to the human race, and as anyone can understand, though, the status quo people have fought it tooth and nail because history of man hasn't changed. The mentality of man hasn't changed. Mm-hmm. The canal people fought the railroad people tooth and nail. And my question has always been this to the power brokers who exist now. Look back at the canal people. What would have happened if the canal people had got in on the ground floor with the railroad people and put in some of their money with the railroad people? Now, they went bankrupt. Mm-hmm. Canal people went out of business. But if they had put some of their money in on the ground floor with the railroad people, they would have made more money and done more for humanity mm-hmm. than the canal system ever could have. The same thing is true here. If all people would put their money in, see it with me, to get this technology produced mm-hmm. for the human race in a massive way, they'd make more money than they ever made off of oil, and they would do more for humanity than all ever has. Now, all has been beneficial. It's been a stepping stone. All through history, God gives us certain technology that carries us so far. But it has reached its limit. It is polluting the earth at a rapid rate.
Something has to be done very quickly. I know that. If you see this one on the market and will be distributed en masse, what do you really think would happen to the, let's say, the economic systems and the people at large? What do you think would happen?
This is going to have a phenomenal beneficial effect upon mm-hmm. the entire human race. Mm-hmm. And I believe that with every fiber of my being. Mm-hmm. Now, Dr. Rasha Hastings, you'll see him on that tape mm-hmm. saying the same thing. I used to teach economics in college. I have a chapter on economics in this book. Mm-hmm. I pay tribute to a teacher I had, Mr. Cooper. And I knew the magnitude of this would be something of this effect. For every job that is displaced by this technology, mm-hmm. it will create hundreds and thousands of new jobs. Because like I said, there'll be young people that'll come forward, this may not even be born yet, that they will create entire new industries with mm-hmm. an energy device that they can run, manufacture anything upon the earth. Mm-hmm. You can do away with pollution. It's a known scientific fact that with enough electricity, you can take any compound, break it down to its basic elements. But it costs too much by present means of trying to do this. Now, this technology will make that no longer to be costly, very inexpensively, mm-hmm. and we will then take what has normally been pollution, turn it back into basic elements, and make useful products out of it. The time will come, and just like I state in this book, the time will come that you'll take pure electromagnetic energy, and you will make mass out of that energy. Now, I'm certain that that is true because you see it throughout the universe. Every element upon this earth is in the sun. The sun takes its mass, converts it into electromagnetic energy, sends it out in the universe. Yeah. Some of it we are captured here on earth. You and I absorb it. Plants absorb mm-hmm. it. They turn it back into mass. Mm-hmm. And we do that consistently throughout the universe. It's obvious to me the time will come and the whole world will be so far advanced mm-hmm. that we will see so primitive and the people and our children and our grandchildren who look back at us, yeah. they will wonder why we did not see this and do this prior to now mm-hmm. because the knowledge has been there. But the status quo has fought it to keep it down, and there's nothing unusual about that.
Well, it's been like that through the ages, and we got to break that cycle. But we do have a clip from a videotape, and I think let's run that tape because there's some good stuff on there. It is right at 10 minutes, and it's very interesting. So let's run the tape, and then we will see from there.
During this week, we've presented scientists and engineers who have tested the machine and not only agreed that the unit works, but that someday it will also power cars, planes, and ships. In short, they believe the invention of Joseph Newman could possibly change the world.
And Joseph Newman's work has been featured on national television and in hundreds of newspapers and magazines throughout the country.
What's the answer to the energy crisis? Suppose a fellow told you the answer was in a machine he has developed. Before you scoff, take a look with Bruce Hall.
In the backwoods of Mississippi, a mile down this dirt road, past the keep out and no trespassing signs, is the workshop of Joe Newman, a brilliant, self-educated inventor who says he has developed a machine that could solve the energy crisis.
What if Someone invented a machine that would make the gasoline engine obsolete. What if someone invented a machine that produced more energy than it used? And that energy is cheap, non-polluting, and safe. That person would probably be hailed as the greatest scientist since Einstein, with a discovery as important as electricity and as revolutionary as the wheel. Joseph Wesley Newman claims to have invented just such a machine. He says that his energy machine could power every American home, farm, business, automobile, and appliance with electricity at a fraction of the present cost. More than 30 scientists and technicians have tested the energy machine, and they agree it works.
Well, it's a fascinating story. First of all, if you can tell stupid people like me as sort of how this machine works.
Okay, Dave, it's basically is that you're not creating anything. You're simply utilizing energy that prior to this time hasn't been understood. It took us several thousand years to ever put a water wheel in moving water. And basically what I'm doing is utilizing the energy in the magnetic field that consists of matter in motion, exactly like a moving river does.
We are back.
Would you welcome, please, Joseph Newman. Nice to meet you.
I appreciate you having me.
Do you think your machine, if it can be commercially made available, can, for example, a person would buy a 300 or 400 pound unit and all of a sudden would be able to produce all of the energy they need for their home? Is that certainly within the realm of possibility?
Exactly. I have absolutely no doubt about it. That such a device hooked to a home, a person will never have to pay for energy again. The device will be made smaller as put in an automobile, plane, spacecraft, you name it, this device.
Using the atoms from the magnetic field.
And what you're doing is that you're converting mass into energy on a 100% conversion process. That's one of the first prototypes, and that's a 700-pound magnetic rotor, and it's got about 8,000 pounds of wire around it. Now, it's gone down. That unit there weighs 135 pounds, and I showed that at the Hilton in New Orleans. There was approximately 2,500 people attended, 1,000 people outside, and another 1,200, 1,500 standing to get in. And it would demonstrate something like 25 times more out than externally inputted into the system.
You get more wattage out of that than...
Than what you'd put in. In fact, a Rayovac battery company is working with me now trying to design a battery to hold up to this recharging effect of this system. Because not only will it run the device, it'll put more energy back into the battery pack than came out of it.
So you could... That's fascinating.
Tell you what, we could stay here all night.
And now 31 people with scientific backgrounds have signed legal documents swearing to the machine's validity.
And Joe's gone beyond what you can read in textbooks. He's an original thinker. There are not many of those.
Newman Motor can now be made ready for practical use in commercial and home energy needs in the very near future. If you doubt this strange story, you are not alone. One of the first to doubt was Dr. Roger Hastings, a PhD in physics from Minnesota. After conducting innumerable tests, Dr. Hastings no longer doubts.
Are you not talking about a machine that would change the world?
Certainly would.
Do you know how crazy that's going to sound to the people watching?
Well, just about as crazy as it sounded to me the first time I heard it. But my point of view is just that I have made measurements, I've seen enough experiments that are just not explainable on the basis of our present understanding of physics. It's something that would really change the world, and it's something that any conscientious person can't walk away from. When you've seen something that puts out more energy than it takes in, and you've taken some measurements that tell you that's true, if you have any conscience at all, you can't walk away from that.
Astronaut Captain Ronald Evans approved the theory and recommended it to NASA. Shortly thereafter, in 1979, Dr. Robert Smith, Chief of Space Environments at NASA, wrote, "Because of your theory, several laws of physics may need to be re-examined." And then, Dr. E.L. Morang, one of the men involved in the making of the atomic bomb, wrote, "Your project will lead to developments that would be beneficial to all mankind."
I think he's found something that's, in my way of thinking, is probably the most significant discovery in the history of man.
There's a lot of people who said Joe believes in perpetual motion, or you get something from nothing. I'm just an old country boy, but I'm a hard-nosed guy. And You got to prove something to me.
The proof, says Newman, is his machine itself and the meters measuring energy in and energy out. They show more coming out and have attracted a flock of engineers and other experts to his backwoods laboratory. Nearly all have come away convinced that the man is onto something that could change the way we live, a virtually limitless source of free, non-polluting energy.
It would be a portable, condensed source of energy that can be taken to anywhere in the world in a suitcase, or perhaps smaller, and no part of the world now would have to be without energy.
For the past 5 months, we've been reporting on an inventor in Mississippi who claims he has a machine that will literally answer all of our energy problems. That's a claim that would seem ridiculous if he didn't have a growing number of experts who agree.
8 slightly used pin-like batteries in series replaced on a motor that was doing virtually no work.
That's it.
The batteries died in 1 minute and 15 seconds. Those dead, dry-cell batteries that are not supposed to recharge were then linked to a portable model of Mr. Newman's invention. The batteries turned a 90-pound magnet for 1 hour and 15 minutes. Then, because of a lack of time on our part, we removed the batteries.